Now coming back to our topic, we were discussing about the anatomy of larynx. Okay. Side to side movement is called of the larynx is called grating sensation, which is also called laryngeal crepitus, which is a sign of laryngeal in some diseases of larynx. This sign is lost, especially hypopharyngeal carcinoma, which has extend up to the larynx, and this hypopharyngeal carcinoma extending up to the larynx will cause the loss of this laryngeal crepitus. Now coming to the anatomy of the laryngeal cartilages, you know laryngeal cartilages are subdivided into unpaired and paired. Unpaired are thyroid, cricoid, epiglottis, and paired one are the arytenoid, caudiculate, and cuneiform cartilage. There are six cartilages, three unpaired and three paired cartilages. Now you can see this is epiglottis. You can see this is thyroid cartilage. This is cricoid cartilage, which is a complete ring. This is arytenoid cartilage, okay, pyramidal shaped. Okay, these are the cuneiform. Here is the are the cuneiform and conicular cartilage. They lies here. Now thyroid cartilage, as you know, thyroid cartilage is a hyaline cartilage, and this is the largest cartilage of the larynx, and it has two alae which are joined with each other in the center. The vocal cord, the two vocal cord especially, which arises from the middle of thyroid cartilage. In next picture you can see this is the lamina of thyroid, one lamina of thyroid cartilage. This is the second lamina of thyroid cartilage. Both are joined in the center, and you can see this vocal ligament is arising from this true vocal cord, which is also called true vocal cord. It is arising from the lamina of the thyroid cartilage. Okay. Now is the cricoid cartilage, which is a complete ring. It is the only laryngeal cartilage which is in the form of a complete ring. It is also hyaline in nature. Its ossification takes place after 25 years in a patchy fashion, small patches of the ossification of this cricoid cartilage can be seen in a patient above 25. And it is sometimes it is misleading if a person especially comes to us with a history of foreign body ingestion, especially bone. So when we take x-ray, sometimes we consider this ossified cricoid cartilage as a foreign body. So it's very important. It's surgical hypothesis. We know the ossification of hyaline cartilage, of cricoid cartilage, does occur after the age of 25 years. Now next is the, yes, you can see this is the diagram of laryngeal cart. This is thyroid cartilage. This is arytenoid cartilage. This is cricoid cartilage, which is a complete ring, okay? And some other cartilage are corniculate cartilage and cuneiform cartilage along the aryepiglottic fold. Now comes the epiglottis. Epiglottis is it's not a hyaline cartilage. It is basically yellow elastic cartilage which never ossifies. Okay? It is a yellow elastic cartilage which never ossifies. And so surgical importance is that after the death of a person, any when we take the X-ray of larynx, the epiglottis, there is, if a foreign body is in epiglottis, it is clearly indicated in the area of epiglottis, a foreign body is present. Never think of ossification. Okay, ossification always misleads you in the case of cricoid cartilage. If a person is having foreign body at the level of epiglottis, never think of ossification, because this epiglottis, it doesn't ossify. Then it forms the anterior wall of laryngeal inlet. It is attached to the hyoid bone, and it is anterior to epiglottis is an area which is called pre-epiglottic space or fat. In this space is a fat basically, and sometimes the carcinoma of the larynx spread to this space, and it is which can be visible on CT scan. And from side of the epiglottis, two fold of the mucosa pass posteriorly to be attached to the retinoid cartilage. This fold is called on the other side peri-epiglottic fold. This area of epiglottis has a rich lymphatic drainage. You can see in the diagram, this is epiglottis, okay? This is attached to the hyoid bone, okay? And these are the mucosal fold, which is called peri-epiglottic fold, which is attached to the, here is the retinoid cartilage, okay? This is peri-epiglottic fold between the epiglottis and the retinoid cartilage, peri-epiglottic fold, okay? You can see this is peri-epiglottic fold. This is peri-epiglottic fold. Okay. This is basically the area of retinoid cartilage, or this is epiglottis. So this fold is called peri-epiglottic fold. This fold contains cuneiform cartilage as well as corniculate cartilage. Corniculate cartilage is lies above the retinoid cartilage. Retinoid cartilage, two in number, they are pyramidal in shape, and it is mostly hyaline, and only its part, some of the part which is at the level of tip is fibroelastic, otherwise it is basically hyaline cartilage. And it has two processes, one is the vocal process and second is the muscular process. The vocal process is attached to vocal cord, and with the muscular process are attached certain muscles. Okay, we will discuss inshallah later on. Now you can see from the diagram, this is retinoid cartilage. Okay, this is which is pyramidal shape. You can see this is the muscular process which lies posteriorly, and this is vocal process which give attachment to the vocal ligament, and this vocal ligament plus this vocal process forms the part of anterior two vocal cord. Okay. This is the, you can see, this is retinoid cartilage. And over the retinoid cartilage, which is pyramidal in shape, lies the cuneiform cartilage. It's just above the retinoid cartilage is the corniculate cartilage. Corniculate cartilage, okay. And you can see this is vocal process to which is attached the true vocal cord, and muscular process lies over here, which gives attachment to the muscles. Now you can see also retinoid cartilage, which is pyramidally shaped. Okay, this is the posterior part, which is insertion to the cricoarytenoideus posterior. Okay, this is muscular process, and this is here lies the vocal process. Okay. Now you can see this is also a picture of true vocal cord. Now comes the corniculate cartilage, which is also paired. it articulates with the retinoid artery. I have shown you in previous picture. Uniform cartilage, which is rod shaped, is situated in periepiglottic fold. Okay, we have already discussed it. Now, certain laryngeal membranes which are important regarding especially clinically are the extrinsic membrane and intrinsic membranes. Extrinsic membranes are a bit important clinically, but intrinsic membranes are very important clinically. Okay. Now we'll discuss the cricovocal membrane. Okay, so cricovocal membrane. Cricovocal membrane. Extrinsic membranes are thyroid membrane, cricothyroid membrane, cricotracheal membrane. Okay, and intrinsic membrane, amongst the intrinsic membrane are the cricovocal membrane and quadrangular membrane. These intrinsic membranes are more important than extrinsic membrane. Okay, this amongst the extrinsic membrane is important, this one, cricothyroid membrane. Why? Because you know, we in emergency one can do cricothyroidectomy. We take a sharp object, a sharp thing, just like knife, and we put it into this membrane, and we make a hole in the area of larynx, which may be helpful in a patient who is choking with some bolus above the larynx. Yeah, in the upper part of larynx. Okay. This cricothyroid membrane is important regarding cricothyroidectomy. Now the cricovocal membrane, this is triangular membrane. Its upper free border stretches between the middle of the thyroid angle to vocal process of the retinoid cartilage and forms the vocal ligament, which is in other words also called true vocal cord. From the lower attachment proceeds upwards and medially, and with the fellow on opposite side forms the conus elasticus. You can show in the diagram. You can see in the diagram. Conus elasticus. It is basically. This area is the conus elasticus. Okay, this area is the conus elasticus, and this is the true vocal cord. Okay, upper border forms the true vocal cords. Okay, and lower part forms the conus elasticus. Now you can see the intrinsic muscles. Now we will discuss about the muscles of the larynx. Okay, after quadrangular membrane, we will discuss about the laryngeal muscles. Quadrangular membrane lies deep to the mucosa of the periepiglottic fold. It stretches between the epiglottis and retinoid cartilage. And its lower border forms the vestibular ligament, which lies in false vocal cord. Basically, its lower border forms the quadrangular membrane's lower border forms the false vocal cord. You can see in this diagram, this is quadrangular membrane, which is between the retinoid cartilage and epiglottis, and its lower border, this one, forms the false vocal cord. Okay. You can see we have discussed previously, this is the cricothyroid membrane. So upper border forms the true vocal cords. Now muscles of the larynx, they are divided into extrinsic and intrinsic, just like membrane. Extrinsic muscles, they attach larynx to the surrounding structures. They are divided into stylopharyngeus, serpingopharyngeus, palatopharyngeus, thyrohyoid, mylohyoid, digastric, stylohyoid, genohyoid, sternothyroids, and sternohyoid, also called strap muscles of the larynx. These are also called strap muscle of the neck and or larynx. You can see these are the laryngeal muscles. You can see stylopharyngeal, styloglossus, palatoglossus, some muscles. And also this diagram, you can see sternohyoid, thyrohyoid, cricohyoid, okay. Yeah, cricothyroid, these are the muscles, sternohyoid. These are the strap muscles of the larynx, which covers the larynx, and they are attached to, they attaches the larynx to the surrounding structures. And when we do tracheostomy, we make a hole in the trachea, we have to split these muscles, okay? Especially sternothyroid. You can see in this diagram the muscles of the extrinsic muscle of the larynx. Now, are the intrinsic muscles. They attach cartilage to each other. Basically, the cartilages of the larynx, they are attached to each other with these, the help of these intrinsic muscles. For example, is the posterior cricoarytenoid, lateral cricoarytenoid, interarytenoid, or arytenoideus, also called arytenoideus, thyroarytenoid, and cricothyroid, and vocalis. These are the intrinsic muscle of the larynx, which attach one cartilage to the other cartilage. And posterior cricoarytenoid is the only abductor of the larynx. This is the only muscle of the larynx which abducts the vocal cord. Okay. If this muscle is damaged, posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, then there will be complete paralysis of the vocal cords, because it is the only abductor. The vocal cord will not abduct, it will be paralyzed, and it will come in the adduction form, also called paramedian form. Okay, clinically, this posterior cricoarytenoid muscle is very important. Now, lateral cricoarytenoid and interarytenoideus, they adduct the vocal cord. Lateral cricoarytenoid and interarytenoideus. Interarytenoid or arytenoideus, they adduct the vocal cords. Cricothyroid muscle lengthens the vocal cords, controls the length of the vocal cord, shortens or lengthens the vocal cord. Thyroarytenoid and vocalis muscle shortens the vocal cord and adjusts the tension of the vocal cord. In diagram, you can see this is posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, which is causing abduction of the vocal cord. Okay, this is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. Posterior cricoarytenoid muscle causing the abduction of the vocal cord. It is the only abductor of the vocal cord. Okay. Interarytenoideus cord is causing the adduction of the vocal cord. You can see this is adduction of the vocal cord. Lateral cricoarytenoid, it also causes adduction of the vocal cord. Okay. In diagram, you can see the vocal cords, they are getting adducted. This is thyroarytenoid, which lengthen the basically vocal cords, controls the tension of the vocal cord. Now coming to the nerve supply of the larynx, laryngeal muscles. Always remember, all the muscles of larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve, except cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by the external laryngeal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. A branch arises from the superior laryngeal nerve, which supplies the external cricothyroid muscle. Or, other than cricothyroid muscle, all the muscles of larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. So if there is paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve, this will paralyze the larynx. Now coming to the cavity of the larynx. In cavity of the larynx, there is a inlet of the larynx, vestibule of the larynx, ventricle of the larynx, subglottic space, vestibular fold, which is called false vocal cord, and vocal fold, which is called true vocal cord, and there is area glottis. We will discuss each entity one by one. Now, inlet of the larynx, it is oblique opening. First is the inlet of larynx, which is a oblique opening, It's bounded anteriorly by the epiglottis, free margin, posteriorly by the interarytenoid fold, and laterally by the periepiglottic fold. You can see this diagram. This is epiglottis, okay, free margin of epiglottis. This is periepiglottic fold, and this is in mucosa between the two arytenoid cartilages. This is the shape of laryngeal inlet. Okay, number one is the true vocal cords. Okay, number two is the false vocal cord. Number three is the epiglottis. Okay, number four is the periepiglottic fold. Number five is the arytenoid cartilage, and number six is the piriform fossa. Okay, and number seven is the posterior part of the tongue. Okay, you have to see one third of the tongue. Vestibule. Vestibule, the laryngeal inlet forms the vestibular fold. After laryngeal inlet is the vestibular fold, which is actually the supraglottis, also called vestibule. Boundaries are the posterior surface of the epiglottis anteriorly, and area epiglottic fold both sides, and mucous membrane over the anterior surface of epiglottis. Its body is almost same as that of the laryngeal inlet. Okay, it is basically, but the difference is that in laryngeal inlet there was a free surface of the epiglottis, and in this case there is posterior surface of the epiglottis. It is just below the laryngeal inlet is the vestibule of the larynx. In diagram you can see this is the area of vestibule, and this is the vestibule of the larynx. This is the area of laryngeal inlet, then is the vestibule of the larynx. Okay, then comes the ventricle or the sinus of the larynx. This is a deep optical space between the vestibular. It is a deep elliptical space between the vestibular and vocal fold. And vestibular and vocal fold. Vestibular folds are the false vocal cord, basically, and vocal folds are the true vocal cords. It extends a short distance above and lateral to the vestibular fold. Diagram, you can understand this. This is the area of ventricle. Okay. This is the area of the ventricle. This is false vocal cord, okay, and this is true vocal cord, and this is the area of ventricle, which is an elliptical area and extends above the false vocal cord, the vestibular fold. Okay. This is, you can see the ventricle. This is a vestibular fold, and this is vocal fold. This is the area of ventricle. Okay. Now comes the saccule. Saccule is a diverticulum of mucous membrane, which starts from interior part of the ventricular cavity. It is a diverticulum of mucous membrane which starts from the interior part of the ventricular cavity and extends upwards between the vestibular fold and lamina of the thyroid cartilage. When it gets enlarged excessively, it distends the larynx and it will produce a swelling of the larynx, which is called laryngocele, which may be seen in the valleculus of the larynx. Okay, Valicula is basically valicula is basically part between the base of tongue and epiglottis. So saccule in diagram, you can see this is the area of saccule. This is the area. Gigi. चले मैं चक्कर एमएनसी में मैं बेटा लेक्चर ले रहा था, मैं लेक्चर लेकर आता हूँ, ठीक है? ऑनलाइन लेक्चर ले रहा था, मैं आता हूँ। अच्छा चलिए, कमिंग बैक अगेन। हाँ, वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द सेक्यूल। Saccule is the area lies close to the ventricle and it extends beyond the post vocal cord. This is saccule. Sometimes the saccule gets enlarged, leading to, you can see in the diagram, this is the area of coming back again. Achha beta. We were discussing the saccule, okay? You can see from this vestibular fold, ventricular fold, ventricle of the larynx, okay, extends the saccule. This is also called laryngocele, which can be seen through larynx, or if it has gone beyond the area of the larynx, it is called external laryngocele. If it lies within the larynx, it is called internal laryngocele. And when it extends beyond the larynx, extend up to the neck, it is called external laryngocele. Okay. In this diagram, you can see this is internal laryngocele. With the help of endoscope, we are seeing the area of the larynx. This is true vocal cord, and this laryngocele is in the area of vestibule, basically. Okay, you can see also this is internal laryngocele, and there may be external laryngocele. This is the diagram of endoscope. Scopic examination of the larynx, in which you can see this is the swelling marked by green arrow. This swelling is called internal laryngocele. When we apply the pressure, when patient takes a deep breath and holds the his breath, his or her breath, and or do Valsalva maneuver, this laryngocele will be prominent. You can see this is the prominent laryngocele. This is external laryngocele. Okay, internal laryngocele can be seen with the help of only endoscope. Now is the subglottic space. It is the I have shown you in the previous pictures. It is the space below the vocal cords, between the vocal lower border of the vocal cords and lower border of cricoid cartilage. The vocal cord tells lower border of cricoid cartilage is the subglottic space. Okay. You can see the diagram. This is the area of the vocal cord. Okay. This is the area of subglottic space. Sometimes the tumor is hidden here and one can not see this tumor with the help of ordinary examination of the larynx with the help of indirect laryngeal mirror or endoscopic examination of the larynx. This area is actually hidden area, which can be only seen with the help of direct laryngoscope. I will discuss Now coming back again. Coming back again. This is the area of subglottis, okay? Now is the vestibular fold, your fourth vocal cord. They are two in number. Each fold of the is a fold of mucous membrane extending anteroposteriorly across the laryngeal cavity. It contains vestibular ligament, few fibers of thyroarytenoideus and mucous membrane. It is basically vestibular fold, false vocal cord. Okay, you can see this is false vocal cord, which is along the lower border of the quadrangular membrane. Okay, this is the false vocal cord. You can see in this area, this is the area of vestibular fold, which is also called false vocal cord. These are the true vocal cords. This is false vocal cord. Another side. Also, you can see this is the area of true vocal cord. This is vestibular fold or false vocal cord. This is vestibular fold, okay? False vocal cord. Now, vocal folds are true vocal cords. They are grayish white, pearly white, two in number. They extend from the middle of thyroid angle to the vocal process of the arytenoid cartilage. Each contains a vocal ligament covered by mucous membrane and scanty subepithelial tissue. Okay, you can see this is true vocal cord. This is true vocal cords. True vocal cord. It is in abducted form and it is in adduction form. When patient say E, this happens. When patient says take a deep breath, this position develops. Okay. Now you can see this is true vocal cord between the, this is the vocal process of the arytenoid cartilage and this is vocal ligament which forms the true vocal cord. When it is covered with mucous membrane, it is called true vocal cord. Now is the glottis, which is the Asuka rima glottis. Rima glottis is basically the elongated space between the vocal cords anteriorly and vocal process of the plus base of arytenoid posteriorly. It's the narrowest part of the larynx, anterior two-third is formed by the mucous membrane, posterior one-third by the vocal process of the arytenoid cartilage. Anterior posteriorly in adult, its length is 24 millimeter and in female 16 millimeters. You can see this is the rhyme.